You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
Hey, how you doing? Good to see you guys. Thanks for tuning in again. Got a great journey to share with you today. And you know what I was thinking? For those of you who are old enough to remember This Is Your Life back in the 1950s, call up the station. We'll talk to you about getting on the show, and you bring in some of your life story, your memorabilia, and we do a show on you. And what a memento would make, what a keepsake to have like your own This Is Your Life. Today, This Is Your Life, we're going to be talking to, we're here, oh, by the way, we're here in Windsor. We're off the set today. We're on location at Lily's in Windsor on Windsor Avenue, and we're going to be talking to our guest, Lieutenant Mark Francis. Mark,
how you doing?
How you doing today?
I'm great. I'm well. Thank you for having me. Well, I really appreciate being here, and my life is a reflection. I don't know how great it is, but I mean, it's been pretty great to me.
Well, but, everybody's got a great life. Everybody's got an amazing story.
Right.
Your story begins in Hartford, Connecticut.
Yep.
And you were born in Hartford.
Yes, sir.
And your father was a Jamaican dude?
Immigrant, yep.
An immigrant.
He immigrated here in 1944. And actually, Windsor, where we're at right now, was one of the first places he came as he picked tobacco. He was actually what you call a soldier of the field. Was under government consignment work to pick tobacco.
So the Windsor, Bloomfield, they were all tobacco companies back in those days.
That's right.
So they got your father up here.
Yep.
And where did you meet your mother? Because your mother is African American from Georgia.
Yep. She's from Americus, Georgia, born and bred. She's a good old Georgia girl. And she migrated here out of the South and looked for better job opportunities.
Well, let me ask you a question. Growing up, getting to know your parents as people, did you notice a difference in the mindset or the psyche of your father, who was born in Jamaica and did not have the same background in terms of slavery and stuff that your mother had? Did you see a difference of the two of them in terms of their perspectives on life and all that stuff?
Yeah, his perspective was a little different. It was a little more independence engaged there. Probably because slavery in the West Indies had been abolished a lot earlier. And the people in the West Indies, or people of color, black people, had a little more feeling of independence. And they had a little different feeling for the institutionalized structure of the past slavery residue. That wasn't really it wasn't something that they had to face really hard times with. It was more classism in the West Indies, I would have to say, from my perspective. Now, my mother, she came out of the South at a young age, but she faced a lot of different things, from segregation and the Jim Crow laws. They were heavy in effect in Georgia. And moving to the North as in a young age, it kind of, some of it became a little different type of approach to certain things that she had to face as being, you know, black, trying to make it in America.
Well, you grew up then in the North End of Hartford.
Correct.
Well, parents were working class, but did both of them have jobs?
Well, actually, both of my parents had more than one job. At any given time, my mother first worked at Kalotni. It was a dress. It was a place where they made dresses, and she worked at Royal Typewriter. And then she had a job working as a seamstress at Winshaw's Bridal Factory. That's not, these places are all since gone, but this was her working experience. She, during her time of working at the bridal factory, she also had another job where she cleaned house. Actually, she cleaned house in West Hartford. It's funny because a lot of these things are intertwined, as I see, you know, these communities. Well, she was hired by family. She worked, a pretty good deal of her time cleaning house there. And someone would say, well, who took care of the kids? You know, because, well, in between my parents working, you know, one would, if they weren't at work, they would be watching the kids. My father, he had a job, he worked with construction, but at that time, you know, due to weather conditions, would get laid off. He worked as an oil delivery man. He worked for Mercury Oil. He also delivered gas for one of the gas companies. I think it was the company last name was White, but he delivered gas. He did odd jobs. You know, he just kind of like kept busy. He always understood that you gotta have something for a rainy day.
Your parents stayed together.
They stayed together for over 50 years until my father passed away just recently in 2011.
Do you think your childhood in a home that was where both parents were present and it was pretty stable and they were both employed, do you think that compared to a lot of what you saw, a lot of your peers and your classmates and your neighborhood friends, so a lot of them came from homes that were not as stable as yours, do you think that made a difference in your life?
That
was helpful?
It made a big difference because you had a certain degree of work ethic. When my parents weren't around, I knew that when they were away, it was about the family. It was about taking care of the family. It was sacrifice being made to buy us things and also take care of the day-to-day needs of the household. And when we did have time together, we spent the time together constructively. I mean, we ate dinner together when we could. We went places together. It was just, like I said, a meager trip to Riverside Park, which is Six Flags or whatever they call it now, but it was Riverside Park. We did it together. And we tried to make the most out of our time as a family, and also we knew that every bit of our parents not being around was because of the sacrifice of having to try to make ends meet.
So you're saying that the the good fortune you have had as a child to have that kind of environment really had a strong effect on you. Environment can affect how you behave and how you relate to the world and to yourself.
Yeah, your environment has a very strong pull on who you are and what you will be.
Well, you went to Rawson School.
That's right.
Elementary school.
Right.
And what was that like? What was your earlier years?
Well, because I was almost always a pretty animated kid. It was an adventure. I've had a lot of great times in my elementary school years, and during that time, it formulated a lot of my opinions. Particularly, like I said, when I was a smaller kid, I guess kindergarten through like fourth grade, I had a lot of hard times. I mean, you know, because there was some nurturing in the family, but because of the clip that my parents had to work, there was a lot of things that, you know, made me kind of, you know, not understand a lot of things and not know how to feel my way through. So I was kind of doing it by myself or through the help of my older sister. I was the baby of my family. And I kind of figured out certain things just by on my own. And also, school was a strong impact, you know, how I dealt with a lot of issues, you know, goofing off. I learned in my environment that, you know, you're going to goof off and do things that you do, but also there's importance of an education, because when my parents ever got wind of when I was goofing off, because they had to work so hard and they understood the importance of a good education, they would get on me pretty tough. Not to mention the whole ideal of teaching was different now. I think teachers, during that time, it was more of a lifestyle instead of a job, which a lot of vocations have changed like that. A lot of people come into jobs and look at the jobs as jobs, and they don't look at it as a, this is my life calling. When I was at Rawson School, I did run into some very good teachers, and I ran into a great one, and he's sitting right there. Well, in those experiences, when I ran into with you, Jeff,
I love this guy,
and I don't call you Jeff. It feels funny for me to call you Jeff, because you were always Mr. Grandy, and Mr. Grandy, you know, was like a part of that village of my upbringing that made us feel like, you know, you were family. I mean, during the times, like I said, I was a product of the 60s and early 70s, you know, in a lot of my impressionable years of developing into a young man. You showed me a lot of things that only a person who cared and had a heartfelt commitment to making me be the best, or your students, not just me, but all of your students, to be the best them that they can possibly be. You want to, I mean, someone will say, well, what did he teach you? I said, it wasn't just the reading, writing, arithmetic. It was some of the heartfelt things that you did, how you would approach us, and you wanted to understand us all. We had times where our parents had to come to school, and you would drop by our houses. Because you want to know what was going on, how was it going on, how you could best reach us. Because I'm sure at the time, and I don't know what your mind was, but I'm sure you wasn't going to try to make everybody a brain surgeon. But you did kind of focus in on how can I get the most out of them? How can I prepare them and make sure that they can get the best out of themselves? Because I see a community here that people are trying hard. And I know my obligation to my profession, to that community, to each one of every one of those kids was, let me make sure that they have a fair chance to make it.
Well, what do you say to a person who says, a person who has struggled, who has not completed their education, they've struggled with employment, they've struggled with life, and they're still poor and maybe had some issues with drugs and other things. It's because they gave up, they're irresponsible and lazy, and it's their own fault. What would you say to somebody who asserted that and told you that? How would you respond to that person?
That's not necessarily so. A lot of times in our lives, we come to crossroads, we come into situations on what our decision making, what decisions we make can have a great impact on where we go and what happens. Some of it is based on luck. And I know in my life, for me to do the things that I did, some of it was ability, some of it was because the ideals and decision making processes that I was formulated to make, but some of it was based on just God's blessings that put me in the right place at the right time. And sometimes some of the bad things that happened was, well, that was just my situation of not having the good fare to be in those places at the wrong time. But also, if I can survive it, I gotta understand that I gotta take something away from it, you know, because having resiliency is the difference between making it and not making it.
Well, Mark, do you think that acknowledging that a lot of the fruit of the results in your life, the life that you've lived, is a result of, at least in part, of you were fortunate to inherit the genes from your parents that made you bright, that made you a very good athlete, and we'll talk about your athletic career later in a minute, but do you think that, that acknowledging that element of luck makes a person more humble and less self-congratulatory by, hey, look, I did it all on my own, it was all my own effort, and you, and those of you who didn't make it, it's because you didn't make the effort, so do you think that's kind of an arrogant attitude to have?
Yes. Well, you know, people are going to act that way. My feeling is none of us are islands. None of us do anything on our own. I mean, even if we're talking about sports, what have you, education, you have to have someone here. The most important commodity on the face of this earth is people, and people working together to help people. That's what we have to keep focus on. If we don't keep focus on that, we become caught up in the dilemmas that we're caught up in now. You know, we stop placing blame. Everybody wants to assign a greater blame to the other, but we got to understand that we all have a responsibility. And actually, the better that you do, or the greater the accomplishments that you make, that gives you more responsibility to help out with people who are less fortunate as you are. Because I always say like this, you know, a person's true greatness is being able to maximize or help someone else maximize the best in them.
Well, that's an interesting concept, because a lot of people who have quote unquote made it, they feel like because I've had my education, I've gotten a job, I've provided for some, you know, a family, my immediate family, that makes me very responsible, and it's your being responsible is entirely, it's your responsibility, mm-hmm, to be responsible,
right?
And I consider myself responsible.
Right.
Do you think that a person who has achieved a high degree of education, reached a high level in the world in terms of the corporate world or the business world or whatever, education world or whatever, and has accumulated a good amount of
wealth,
material wealth, that automatically confers upon them responsibility? Or do you think that people, no matter where they are in the socioeconomic spectrum, have a responsibility not only to themselves but to each other, like you were just suggesting?
Right. Well, my feeling on that is, you know, that's one facet of some achievement, but later on, when we're talking about materialism, about money that we can create or jobs we can achieve, you know, someone will say, hey Mark, you were a lieutenant in the police department, you know, don't you feel good about that? I really never thought about that too much. I mean, you know, I guess at the time I'm achieving these ranks or stuff like that, it was something of importance, but I look back on my career not as that. I look back on my career on the people I helped, the things that I did to help people who couldn't help themselves, because I was like, I'm pretty well, you know, I'm okay, I'm good in this world, but who can I touch and make better? Because that is where you're, to me, Your greatness, or your greatness of your capacity comes from. If I see a king or a queen, oh, I guess it's nice to be a king or a queen, but what is your king or a queen's responsibility? It's to take care of their least of their subjects. And I'm not talking about the greatest of their subjects, the ones with the extreme wealth. They're already okay. But to teach them to take care of each other. And a lot of our problems that we have on this earth is because we sometimes lose sight of what's important on this earth. Whether you believe in creation or evolution, the most important commodity on the face of this earth is the people. It's not a mountain, it's not diamonds on the ground or gold in the mountain, or none of that is important. those are only things that we can get, resources that we can get to help to modify or better people. Well, we can't put so much emphasis on that. We got to put the emphasis on how do we make mankind, and not the greatest of mankind, because almost the people in the higher, or people who are physically fit or in financially good places, kind of can take care of themselves as the ones that can't. Why do we provide a maximum amount of care to a baby? Because it can't take care of itself. And what do? We nurture it to see that it can take care of itself. Well, sometimes that process is a little, it takes a little longer with people. And we can't look at all the reasons why they can't function like you, or like some people that we see that are well-to-do. We have to function on what does it take, or what can we do to make sure on a level that we can have more people, or actually have more people to sustain and survive at what can be an adequate standard of living.
Well, people have told me that they've overheard you say that along the lines of what you're talking about, that every child, every infant who's brought into this world, no matter where it is on the planet, every infant that's brought into this world deserves to be brought into the world, into a collective, into a society, into a civilization that is willing to provide them, that feels it's their responsibility, not just the parents, but it's everybody's responsibility collectively to assure an innocent child born into this world every opportunity that allows them to reach their potential. I've talked to some people who know you, and they have said that you've shared that opinion with them. Is that true?
Well, that's wholeheartedly what I believe in. I believe that, you know, we have a duty. If we're the great society of America, and we live at a, you know, the highest standard on the face of this earth, we have to make sure that our people who are in the worst situation, that we can witness with here, that we can elevate them. We got to elevate them better to a better place that we can say, because like I said probably a little bit earlier, that your true greatness or a person's true greatness is not what they can just do for themselves. It's how they can make something in a worse situation in a better situation. That's why we're human beings. We're reasoning beings. We're supposed to be able to make environmental changes if we need to. We can make changes with wildlife. We can do a lot of things. That shows your true greatness. Well, if you can't do it with your own species, how could you do it with anything else? You have to be able to do it for your own species. And particularly here in America, I look at our country and I say, have we done all that we should be doing for ourselves? And sometimes I have to say we have to challenge that.
Well, you've had a ringside seat. Let's just back up a little bit. Mm-hmm. Go back to your just very briefly. You went to Weaver High School.
Exactly.
And you were bestowed with some nature bestowed upon you, some great athleticism, and you were also a good student. I know when you were in my class, you got good grades and you were an awesome athlete. What happened at Weaver? Did you continue with your athletics at Weaver?
Yeah, I continued with my athletics at Weaver. I ended up playing football there and ran track. And I had a pretty good athletic career. I don't like to dwell to it, but it was a good vehicle to get me out.
Well, what happened after high school? You played college too, didn't you?
Yeah, I played college football at Lexington University. And actually, I didn't go there with the intent of an education. The football was the vehicle. I'm not going to make any bones about that. Football was the vehicle for me to do what I did. But once I got there and got exposed to a lot of new things, it made me say, well, I'm here and all of these new things are around me in this institution of learning. And I'm like, I fell in love with the criminal justice system. I mean, it was something that was all around me, because in the neighborhood I grew up in, there was crime. There was quite a bit of it. And it was something that I personally knew pretty well. And I said, well, there are some things in anything that you're interested in. How do you fit in it? How can you make some changes for the better in it, or get more production in that area? But that's my opinion of why you go into something, and that's what I did, and I majored in criminal justice.
What did you get your degree in?
Criminal justice and corrections.
A bachelor's?
Yes,
a bachelor's. You did get a bachelor's?
Yes.
You graduated from college?
Yes, I did.
You tried out with the Seattle Seahawks.
Well,
you had a little bit of a.
They had some interest.
And you played semi-pro ball.
Yes, I did.
What was your position?
I was a cornerback and a safety and a punt returner and a kickoff.
So you put a lot of nasty hits on people.
Some I regret, and that was an experience. But like I said, it was a vehicle, and it was something that, you know, that I thought that I wanted to do until I really got to college and to see really where do I serve more purpose. And I serve more purpose not just being an entertainer, but being a person who can help people in some type of way, shape, or form.
So you wind up back in Hartford?
Back in Hartford.
And what did you do?
And after, I mean, between trying to pursue football and do those type of things, I had to get some income coming in, because, you know, on a semi-pro level, you're not paid very well. So I ended up getting a job substitute teaching, and actually the teaching may have came from the experiences that I had with you. I wasn't probably the best equipped to be a teacher, other than I cared about the students that I taught, but I didn't have all the academic criteria. So I actually only could get a job as a substitute, which was fine, because it did give me an experience about what the teaching profession takes. I knew that I wasn't so equipped for it, so I later on transferred and changed my direction, and I got a job working at a reform school, which was along the lines of criminal justice, and then also was with juveniles.
That was Long Lane, right?
Long Lane School, yep. I worked there for 4 years. And it was one of the most invigorating experiences that I ever had. I would have to say, because it was always built, these are the worst of the Connecticut has to offer, the kids. And what I saw there, when I got there and I was around those kids, I didn't see that. I saw these are some kids that have been put in some impossible situations. And anybody that could have saw some of the kids that we had in that institution, by the way that they were brought into this world, they were at risk. Before they even set foot on this planet, they were at risk. They were born to parents who were somewhat impossible situations. Not everyone, but for the most part, if I had to say the gross majority was put in such bad situation before they set foot on this earth, you can predict what was going to happen. But one thing I did see in a lot of those kids, I did see resiliency. I saw them being able to smile and laugh and come with good ideals when put in proper situation, and good decision making when put in the proper situation, because that's what the facility was structured for. It was structured to mend some of the bad behavior that had gotten them there. And during most of those kids' stint there, they put together good behavior. And I would have to say, in most cases, 80% of the time that they were there, they had good behavior. So that showed that they did have it in them under the right stimulus.
We got to, folks, we've got so much to cover, and I think you'll all agree with me. Mark has a lot, so much to share, that we're going to do this month's show a half hour that we just wrapped up, and then we're going to do another half hour for next month's show. And so we will I'm kind of here ahead of time saying welcome back to part two of the Mark Francis Show, Journeys with Jeff, and we're just going to continue our conversation with Mark, and again Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for your interest. Please call the station if you want to talk to Mark. If you have any questions, any comments, I can always forward them to Mark. If you want to come in and share your story, we'd be very happy to talk to you about that. And again, we'll resume back where we are with Mark.